Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time. We thank you because you have reminded us, whatever we have, the skill, the talent, the ability, the strength, the power, the education, the job, whatever it is we have, love so amazing, so divine, demands our soul, our life, and our all. We yield ourselves to you today, accept our offering in Jesus' name. We give our hearts to you. We give our lives to you. We give our present to you. We give our future to you. We give everything we have unto you. Receive everything in Jesus' name. All that we have, because you gave everything you have unto us, with you, we give everything we have back unto you in Jesus' name. There is nothing we have which you have not given unto us. And everything belongs to you. Before we came to this world, you already had everything. You owned everything. You possessed everything. Now we came into this world, and you have given us some things. Things that are spiritual, things that are natural, things that are physical, things that are tangible. Lord, we pray, everything we offer back to you in Jesus' name. Everything we have, everything within us, everything we will ever have, everything belongs to you. Lay hold on them and possess everything for your use in Jesus' name. We'll give to you without grumbling. We'll give to you without complaining. We'll give to you without grudging. We'll give to you without comparing ourselves to other people. We'll give to you freely. We'll give to you willingly. We'll give to you readily. We'll give to you without question. We'll give to you without sadness. We'll give everything we have to you cheerfully in Jesus' name. Speak to our hearts, Lord, today. And we pray, Lord, as we offer everything to you, it will be acceptable to you in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said a good amen. God bless you. You can be seated. We're looking at Matthew chapter 22. In Matthew chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 21. Matthew chapter 22, verse 21, they say unto him, Caesar's. Then said he unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's. In Mark chapter 12, Mark chapter 12, reading from verse 17, and Jesus answering says, said unto them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. In Luke chapter 20, verse 25, Luke chapter 20, verse 25, and he said unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which be Caesar's, and unto God the things which be God's. We learn a great lesson from what Jesus Christ said to these Pharisees and Sadducees and Herodians. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ gave an important message of great significance at the most unexpected time. At the most unexpected time, Jesus always did something marvelous. Look at the greatest of the miracles of Jesus Christ. They happened at the most unexpected place. Look at some of the people that were saved. Those people, the salvation happened at the most unexpected time, like the thief on the cross. Look at the people that were called into the ministry, like Matthew on the sea, on the roadside. His call into salvation and service happened at the most unexpected time. And that's why you cannot take the Lord Jesus Christ for granted. At the most unexpected time, he brings you a message of great significance. The Pharisees, concerned and jealous about the impact of the miracles of Jesus and the messages of Jesus, they sent flatterers and spies to the Lord Jesus Christ. What did they send those flatterers to do? Matthew tells us in Matthew chapter 22 verse 15 that they sent them so that they might entangle him in his talk. Look at that, Matthew chapter 22 verse 15. It says, and then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. They came for entanglement. They came to rope him in into trouble. And they came to make him oppose either the government or the Jewish people. And it was at this unexpected time that this great answer of great significance came out of his lips. In fact, Mark tells us in chapter 12, verse 13, that what they wanted to do, they wanted to catch him in his words. Means the same thing, to entangle him in his talk, or to catch him in his word. In Mark chapter 12, verse 13, and he sent unto him certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians to catch him in his words. Luke tells us in a slightly different way. And what Luke says throws light into what these Pharisees and Sadducees and Herodians, what they came to do, their purpose and their plan. They wanted to hand him over to the powers that be so that they can destroy him and destroy his ministry. That's all they wanted to do. They wanted to destroy him by flattery and by fear words. But Jesus Christ gave them the answer. Then, whose superscription, whose image is stamped on this coin? They said, the image of Caesar. How is it the authorities in the land of Israel will make use of the coin that has the image and the superscription of Caesar? Is it not true that the image on the coin shows the person that you are deliberately, politically submissive to? Well, the coin belonged to Caesar. Give it back to Caesar. But do you know, when God created you, he put his image in your heart. Because man was created in the image of God. Your image or the image of God is not on the coin. The image of God is on the heart. And therefore you will give to God wherever the image is. The image on the coin is the image of Caesar. Give that to Caesar. Be politically submissive unto Caesar, and whatever political civil laws come from Caesar, from his government, obey, because that's his image. Do you see your heart? Do you see that God has put his stamp, his image in your heart? So God created man in the image of God, created he him. Because the image of God is stamped on your heart. Give that heart back to the Lord, and give your worship back to the Lord, and give your submission back to the Lord. When he gave them that answer, he was teaching them, number one, our responsibility towards the civil government. Number two, our obedience and submission to God. True believers must obey the civil government in all matters which are temporal. He must render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's. That means in all matters that are temporal, civil, concerning society, you obey the laws of the land. But in all matters that are spiritual, we must be consecrated. We must be obedient to the God of the Bible and must never do whatever the Bible forbids. Even if the powers that be are offended, and even if the powers that be persecute us, our heart is not for them. Our heart is for the Lord. Our worship is for the Lord. Our obedience is for the Lord. Because the human government cannot determine our eternity. The hold of the government ends when you die. After you have died, the government has no authority over you anymore. They will not even try to manifest any authority over you anymore. But after you are dead, you will go back to God. Because in eternity, God will show you that He is still the King of the whole universe. All through eternity, we belong to God by creation. And we belong to God by redemption. And the reality of divine ownership on us demands that at all times and in all things we demonstrate consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Why did these Pharisees come like this? Didn't they understand? Even from the Old Testament in Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2. Did they have to be told that their lives belong to God? Their hearts belong to God. Everything who they were, they belong to the Lord. Because it tells us, Jeremiah chapter 2, reading in verse 3, Israel was holiness unto the Lord, and the first fruits of his increase. All that devour him shall offend. Evil shall come upon them, says the Lord. Holiness unto the Lord. That was what Israel had known and learned, and they should still have stayed in that. I want you to look at Isaiah chapter 43. Chapter 43, verse 7. Even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. They should have known that they belonged to God, and they should worship God, and there should have been no question about it. Then we are told in verse 21, these people have I formed for myself. These people have I made for myself. Therefore, if you are not totally given to God, if you are not totally surrendered to God, if you are not totally consecrated to God, something is missing. You are not in the right place the Lord wants you to be. These people have I formed for myself. They shall show forth my praise. And of course, as you come to the New Testament, you understand the same thing in 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We belong to the Lord. That's why today we're talking about this important thing that Jesus Christ himself spoke about. The subject I'm talking about today is consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Consecration and holiness unto the Lord. There are 3 points we're going to deal with. Number one, our conversion and ownership by the Lord. In the moment you are converted, you are born again, you realize now you belong to the Lord in a double sense. One, you belong to the Lord because he created you. Two, you belong to the Lord because he has saved you. You become a member of the family of God. Double ownership of the Lord upon your life. Number two, our consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Our consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Number three, our continuation in holiness and love. Our continuation in holiness and love. Number one, our conversion and holiness by and ownership by the Lord. Conversion and ownership. There is a fitting illustration in the Old Testament. Actually, the Lord had told the children of Israel, and he had said they all belonged to him. That's why he said, let my people go. They are all my people, all the children of Israel. You know why? Because at that time, when they were to come out of the land of Egypt, the Lord said that he will kill the lamb, and he will shed the blood, and he will put the blood upon the lintels of their houses. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And after that happened, he said, now, because you are redeemed, you all belong to me. As they were going on in the wilderness, something happened. The children of Israel began, they began to worship idol. And because they worshipped idol, while Moses went to the mount to receive the law from the hand of the Lord said, because they are backsliding, I disinherit them. They are not mine anymore. I disinherit them. They do not belong to me anymore. Because of sin that entered into their camp, God is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. They are not mine. Go back to your people. God said, my people, am I the one that saved them? Well, they are your people. Humanly speaking, since they don't belong to me anymore, they are yours. I give them to you. Do with them whatever you want to do, because they have corrupted themselves. And then Moses came to the people and he challenged them. He confronted them. How could you do this? And he confronted Aaron. Why have you done this? And then after preaching to them and exhorting them and challenging them and correcting them, I mean firm with them, he said in Exodus chapter 32 verse 26, Exodus 32 verse 26, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side, let him come unto me. A call to conversion. A call to conversion and restoration. A call to come to the side of the Lord. Who is going to decide now? The whole of Israel, they are backsliding, and they have gone away from me. Are you all going to perish in the wilderness, separated from the Almighty God? I'm asking you, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. Can I remind you that? Let him come unto me. Remember those words? Come unto me. Come unto me. Come unto me. Are those not the words that Jesus repeated many years later? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So Moses invited them, let him come unto me. We're told in that Exodus 32:26, and all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. They responded. They said, we're sorry for what we have done. We're sorry because we went away with the rest of the people in worshiping idol. After that conversion, after they gave themselves to the Lord, look at what the Lord said in Numbers chapter 8. Numbers chapter 8 verse 14. Thus shalt thou separate the Levites from among the children of Israel, and the Levites shall be mine. Ownership. Because they gave themselves to the Lord, and he said, we now belong to the Lord. We're sorry for what we have done. We come out of idolatry, and we come to the Lord, and we surrender and yield ourselves to the Lord. It's the same thing today. When you give yourself to the Lord, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Like all the children of Israel sinned, and they came short of the glory of God. And then the evangelist comes. That evangelist may be Peter, may be Stephen, that evangelist may be Philip or Moses, whatever name, and he says, who wants to be on the Lord's side? Because everybody has gone astray, we have all gone our own way, but who now is making a decision to come to the side of the Lord? If you, like the Levites, if you say, I come to the side of the Lord, I believe on the Lord, my sins, I want my sins to be forgiven, and then your sins are forgiven, you become a child of God, you are converted, and the Spirit of God bears witness in your heart, you are now a child of God. After that conversion, there's divine ownership. The Lord now owns you. The Lord now possesses you. We're told in Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32 verse 6. Do ye thus requite the Lord, O foolish people? Is not he thy father that has bought thee? Has he not made thee and established thee? Don't you know that you are not just ordinary? He has purchased you. He has redeemed you. He has bought you. You see that word there? When you buy something, that thing you buy, you have ownership. You can claim ownership of that thing because you paid the full price for that thing. Oh, the same thing, the price of the blood of Jesus. It's what the Lord has used to purchase us and to buy us and to bring us unto himself. Oh, the love that sought me. Oh, the blood that bought me. Oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. Didn't you see? He pointed to the nail prints. For me, his blood was shed. A mocking crown so sunny was placed upon his head. And I wondered what he saw in me to suffer such agony. It's love. The love that sought me. And the blood that bought me. You are bought. And because you are bought, he possesses you. He owns you. There is divine ownership upon your life. In verse 9 of that same Deuteronomy chapter 32. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the Lord of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste, howling wilderness. He led him about and he instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. All those references, they show you that actually the Lord owns you. If you are born again, he owns you, he owns your life, he owns your time, he owns your talent, and he can do with whatever you have as it pleases him, because they belong to him. Isaiah chapter 1, reading from verse 16, wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. It's like when Moses came to those children of Israel and he said, see what you have done. Idolatry is evil. You are forsaking the Lord who brought you out of the land of captivity. Now come to the Lord's side. And then he took that idol. He ground everything to powder. And then he even punished them, disciplined them, put it in water, made them to drink it. And now, after that, he gave the call. And that's what the Lord, that's the call the Lord is making to whoever has not come to know the Lord. In verse 17, learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widows. Then the Lord said, come now. You still have to take a step. You still have to respond. If you sit down there and where the Lord is saying, you're not in the right place. I bought you. I cleansed you. I purchased you. I paid the full price on your behalf. And I'm preparing a mansion for you in heaven. Come. Come now. If you don't change, if you don't turn, if you don't rise up, if you don't leave all the place of the sin and the idolatry and the evil, and you don't come to the Lord, how will that be? When the Lord is showing his tender love towards you, come now, verse 18, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. He wants us to come because we belong unto him. This is what is called conversion. This is what is called conversion. And after that conversion, you belong to the Lord. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 3. Acts chapter 3. Verse 19, repent ye therefore and be converted. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Sins. You see what he mentioned there? Sins. Please understand, my brothers and sisters, our friends and invitees who are here today, you have to use the vocabulary of God. Because if you use your own vocabulary, you will not understand the language of God. Because God will not lower himself, will not condescend, bring himself low to your vocabulary. You must get up to the level of the vocabulary of God. Because, you know, there are many people, when they say sins, S-I-N-S, they do not understand it the way God understands it. Look at this in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, reading from verse 29. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, yes, that's sin. We all accept. Wickedness, yes, that's sin. Covetousness, that one. Covetousness. Covetousness is not stealing. Covetousness is just desire. You see what others have. You see what others possess. You covet. You are not stealing it. You are just desiring it. I wish it were mine. I wish it were mine. Covetousness, in the language of Almighty God, it is sin. Maliciousness, malice. I will not greet you. You don't greet me. I hate you. Even though I'm not slapping you and I'm not boxing you, I hate you. Don't smile at me. Until we get to heaven, nobody will settle it for us. It's sin. And that sin of malice will cut you off from heaven and cut you off from relationship with God. Full of envy. You see another person succeeding, you are envious, you are jealous. Why them? Why him? Why not me? You see another person having a position and a privilege, you are jealous. Why not me? And that jealousy, that envy, fills your heart. That even when you should rejoice with them that rejoice, be happy, because these other people, they are happy. Something good is happening in their lives, you are not happy. It's envy, it is sin. Murder, when you kill. You know that many people, they kill in different ways. I mean, even in the ancient days, they didn't always use a knife or dagger or gun to kill. There were people that they just, you know, poisoned, and as they poisoned them, they died. It's still murder. And there are people that, you know, will not allow an innocent child to live. And that child, the Lord might have been preparing that child to be a doctor, to be an engineer, to be an evangelist, to be a pastor, to be a preacher, to be somebody that will do something significant in life. But I don't want any other child. Who are you? Is it you that will not want any other child, or the Almighty God who has decided that child will come to life? I'm ashamed. I cannot bear this child because actually it was out of wedlock. Because, you know, I've not married the man, and the man had not paid anything on me. And see my condition now, I am ashamed. It's happened. Carry the pregnancy. If you terminate the pregnancy, you might be killing a Jephthah before Jephthah is born. And Jephthah became a mighty man and a mighty warrior and a mighty deliverer over the for the children of Israel. And he was born out of wedlock. It was like, you know, all the other children called him a bastard. But all the other legitimate children, they did nothing significant. It was Jephthah, the bastard, that delivered the nation. Don't kill Jephthah before Jephthah is born. Because you see, that is murder, and it's a sin and debate. You know that is sin. After we finish the service and you have heard the word of God, and you go behind there, or you are talking in the car and you are debating pro con. I agree, I don't agree. That thing that they said in the church today, what do you think about it? Love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. Can you do that? Are you listening to them? You know, we just go to church and we take the ones we want to take, and the ones we cannot take, we drop it for them. No problem. There is problem. There is problem. There is problem. Because you are living in sin, when you argue and debate against the word of God, deceit, malignity, whisperers. Is that a sin? In our vocabulary. Don't let them know I told you. Give me your ears. I don't want to say it loud so that people will not hear. Whispering, gossiping, backbiting. And it is sin. And the backbiting, the gossiping, shows that we are not in relationship with God at present. That's why it says that you repent and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Whispering, gossiping, tail bearing, backbiting is sin. And that's why I challenged you. Drop your own vocabulary and use the vocabulary of God himself. Haters of God, despiteful, despiteful. And you know, sometimes you're happy, you've done something marvelous for the Lord, and you know, you're just happy. You see, this is the best day of my life since I became born again. See, the Lord helped me, and I did this, and I did this, and you're full of joy and excitement. And then somebody will look at you like this, as if you should have been thrown into the latrine. That you are so dirty and you are so bad. What's making you happy? Why are you laughing? Why are you joyful? And he looks at you as if you are the dirtiest thing on the earth, that we should throw you into the latrine. And they despise the things that are good. And they despise the people that are good. That's sin. Despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. Is that sin? Disobedient to parents, is that sin? My little girl, your father is a zonal leader. Your father is a house fellowship leader. Your father is a coordinator. When your father stands up in our church and he teaches, we listen. See, even myself, if your father, your father who is a coordinator, your father who is a zonal leader, if he stands here teaching such the scripture and I'm sitting down, if I listen to something that I have forgotten, and your father, little girl, little boy, your father mentions something that I have forgotten, I will mark it in my Bible. I will pray to the Lord, oh Lord, help me. I'm telling you that I myself, when your father preaches something that knocks me and touches me and stirs me up, I go on my knees and I say, Lord, help me. I don't despise your father's zonal leader because he's a zonal leader and because I'm his general superintendent. And you little girl, your father told you something at home, and you little boy, your father told you something at home and said, my girl, my boy, here is the word of God, and you disobey your parents. God have mercy on you, because you know disobedience to parents is sin. And then it tells us, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. They which commit such things as what? As backbiting, as debating, debating against the word of God, as malice, as murder, as abortion, as haters of God, as boasting, pride. They which commit such things are worthy of death. Not only do the same, they support, they encourage, they assist, they have pleasure in them that do them. That's why the sinner, the backslider needs conversion. That's why it says in Acts chapter 3 verse 19, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. In verse 26, unto you, first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you, in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. Now when that conversion takes place, I told you already, ownership then belongs to the Lord. He owns you because he has bought you. He owns you because he has forgiven you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. From verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor the effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed. You were like that. But now, you have come to the Lord and you are washed. After you are washed, after you are forgiven, after you become forgiven and saved. How about the next sin? Ownership. Look at verse 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought. Ye are bought. Ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Ownership. Divine ownership. Our conversion and ownership by the Lord. From now on, what's to be your language? From now on, what are you to say when you are talking to God? From now on, how are you to think whenever you are thinking about God? Can I show you? I said, can I show you? What's to be your language? What's to be your attitude? What's to be the pronouncement coming out of your mouth if you are born again? If you are a child of God, and you realize now there is divine ownership on you. Look at the language now. This must be your language. You mark it in your Bible. I've marked it in my Bible too. 1 Kings chapter 20 verse 4. 1 Kings chapter 20 verse 4. Are you there? Have you opened it? I'm waiting. Have you opened it? Okay, 1 Kings chapter 20 verse 4. And the king of Israel answered and said, here is your language. Here is what you must say. When you realize you are bought, you are purchased, you are redeemed, you are forgiven, you are a member of the family of God. Here is what you are to tell the Lord. My Lord, O King, according to thy saying, I am thine and all that I have. Can you say that after me? My Lord, O King, according to thy saying, I am thine, and all that I have. Can you say that again? My Lord, O King, according to thy saying, I am thine, and all that I have. Say it yourself now. Say it aloud. Won't you go? Thank you very much. God owns you and possesses you. That means then yourself and your possession, they belong to God. Paying your tithes is small, little evidence that you know that you belong to God. When you don't pay that tithe, it's like you are forgotten the divine ownership of the Lord upon your life. In Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3 verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. When last did you pay your tithe? I don't mean the 5 naira you put in the offering bag. That's not tithe. Because if you put 5 naira, are you receiving 50 naira as salary? I don't mean the 100 naira you put there. Because if you put 100 naira, are you receiving 1,000 naira as salary? A tithe is 1/10 of your income. And isn't God wonderful that even though he owns us, I am thine, and all that I have, everything belongs to God, and yet he says, keep 9/10. 9/10. Keep 90% for yourself. I only demand 10%. And then out of the 10%, we're still stealing. We're robbing God. We're not giving God his due, his right, what belongs to him. In Malachi chapter 3 verse 8, will a man rob God? Yet he have robbed me. But she say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offering. Yeah, there should even be additional offering over the tithe as a recognition. I belong to God. My money belongs to God. My strength belongs to God. My ability belongs to God. As I go to the market and I make some gain, the strength I add, the healing I add, everything belongs to God. The sun that is shining, that belongs to God. The ground on which I'm walking, everything belongs to God. The water I am drinking, everything belongs to God. God, what keeps me alive and keeps me energetic to be running up and down and doing business or going to the office, all that belongs to God as an evidence that you realize that everything belongs to God, you bring a tithe unto him. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Ye are cursed with a curse. For ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes, not part of the tithe. If you want to show that you belong to God, if you want to show that, yes, I am thine and all that I have. Here is what the Lord is telling you. Here is what the Lord is telling me. And there is no up and down, young and old in this. You are a school child and you have pocket money. You belong to God if you are born again. And all that you have belongs to God. You will not spend everything in buying biscuits or buying clothes or buying whatever you want to buy. But you will pay your tithe. You say, but it doesn't, it's a little amount. I only have 50 naira that somebody gave me. Put the tithe aside for God. Whether it is small or it is big, it is not the size. It is not how big. It is a recognition of your conversion and divine ownership. Verse 10, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and put me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. The blessings of God will come when we are obedient to the Lord. When God gives you something moderate and then you pay tithes out of that, then you are qualifying yourself for greater blessings from the Lord, because the Lord knows you'll be faithful. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and it shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast out fruit before the time in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed, for ye shall be a delightsome land, says the Lord of hosts. I go to point number 2. Our consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Our consecration and holiness unto the Lord. Actually, when you become a child of God, God sets you apart for himself. Listen, when you become a child of God, and God knows in his register, in the book that he keeps, that he has this person, has this person, has this person, he sets you apart for himself. That's the reason there should not be any lack for workers in the church of the living God. When we understand the ownership of the Lord upon us, and the Lord can easily come to me and can talk to me, and then I will come to you and I'll say, brother, we know you are born again. You are a child of God. We thank God for your life. Go and join the ushers. And you cannot say, Pastor, I'm sorry, I don't have time. Because the time belongs to God. You belong to God. All that you have belongs to God. We're singing and I'm going around. And I hear you singing with a very melodious voice. My sister, what's your name? You say, I'm Ngozi. I say, are you in the choir? You say, no, Pastor. I say, come on, follow me now. And then I say, sit down here where the members of the choir are. You are now a member of the choir. You cannot say, excuse me, Pastor, before you go, I don't have time. I'm doing evening classes. You cannot say that, because you belong to God. And everything you have belongs to God. And then I see you, you come over here. And I maybe have not been listening to you, but I've not heard you teach before. You come over here and you teach. And while you are teaching, God ministers to me that that's one of the pastors right there. He's been hiding in the crowd. Now you brought him out today. Did you listen to him? My anointing, the unction is upon him. I have ordained him and appointed him. And I call you and say, brother, don't go yet. Come on here. What are you doing? He said, well, I am a trader. You are a trader. Wonderful. How much money do you make? You say, I'm making, you know, in 1 year I can make $1 million, $2 million. I said, that has come to an end. You are now a stage overseer. Excuse me, sir. I'm the only son of my parents. Don't talk. I said, God said, you are now a stage overseer. I surrender all. Am I right? That's the watch of God. If you belong to the Lord, everything you have belongs to the Lord. And you cannot say, I am sorry, I cannot do this, I am sorry, I cannot do that. We have enough coordinators, we have enough zonal leaders, we have enough missionaries, and we have enough pastors, and we have enough dynamic evangelists in this church. The only thing is, many of us, we have not realized that it doesn't depend on when you are ready. It is when God says, he lays his hand upon you, then he claims your life, and he claims your talent, and he claims everything that you have. You belong unto the Lord. There are few of us that have realized that, and they never argue. Immediately you just tell them, thus says the Lord. The Lord now wants you to leave your secular work. He wants you to do this. He wants you to do that. Thank you, Jesus. That's what I've been waiting for. Anytime you call me, I am ready. Because if you are a child of God, he has set apart the people that are born again unto himself. Look at Psalm 4, verse 3. Psalm 4, verse 3. But know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. But know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. He has set you apart for himself. If he has not picked you up and he has not sent you to that local government to be the pastor there, he has not sent you to that region to be the overseer there, he has not sent you to that country to be the overseer here, there, it's just that he's waiting. It's not waiting because you are not ready, because you should be ready every time. He has set apart him that is godly for himself. And that's what the Lord does, our consecration and holiness unto the Lord. In Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 1 and from verse 2. Romans chapter 12 verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies. And whenever we read this, we don't understand. Your bodies, your brain. I want to be an engineer. I want to be a mathematician. I want to be a medical doctor. I want to use this my brain to do this and to do that. Don't go far. present your being to the Lord. I have dexterity, ability with my hand. I can do anything. I know how to walk. I know how to do this. If any machine breaks now, I can use this hand and repair it. And when I get older, or when I get capital, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. Don't talk too much. Present your hands unto the Lord. You present your body unto the Lord at this present time now. Whatever my hand finds to do, whatever my voice finds to sing, whatever my eyes find to read, whatever my brain finds to think about, I do it with all my strength. And I live, when tomorrow comes, God will supply the strength for tomorrow. And that's how to serve the Lord, that at this present time now, you consecrate, you surrender, and you devote, you dedicate, you present your bodies, everything that you have unto God, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And that's what the Lord is saying. As we belong to Him, we present everything we have, we consecrate everything we have unto Him. In Leviticus chapter 22, Leviticus chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 20. Leviticus 22, verse 20. And whatsoever has a blemish, that shall not, ye shall not offer, for it shall not be acceptable for you. That's where holiness comes in, to the consecration. We cannot just say, I surrender all to Jesus, I surrender. That thing you say you want to surrender, clean it up. Wash it clean. Purge it, purify it. Don't just come and give something to God that you cannot give to your neighbor. And sometimes those brothers who count the offering, have you not seen sometimes brothers and sisters that the kind of currency note, squeezed, dirty, you almost will not see the marks anymore, that if you spend it, if you go to the market and you give the one that you are going to buy rice or beans from, the fellow will throw it back to you. What kind of money are you giving? I cannot take this one. Bring the good money, bring good money out. And then you go into your pocket and then you give them good money. The one they reject in the market, the one they rice seller, pepper seller, the one that they reject, when we say, now we're going to give our tithes and offering to the Lord. That dirty money that has no value anymore. We almost cannot see the print on that note anymore. You raise it up. Now, bless this offering. And all the people that offer this, bless them also. Then you drop the dirty thing there. How about the clean ones? How about the good ones? Where are they? That one is for buying rice. That's how you treat your God. You see, anything we're going to give to God, our lives, our heart, our possession, and the money, anything we're giving to God, make it the very best. That's why it says in this Leviticus, and whatsoever has a blemish, that shall ye not offer, for it shall not be acceptable for you. And whosoever offereth the sacrifice of his offering unto the Lord to accomplish his vow, or a free will offering in beeves or sheep, it shall be perfect, to be acceptable. There shall be no blemish therein. After God told them that, some of those Israelites, you know, the Lord still told them, did you hear what I told you? That when you're offering something to me, it must be good. Look at Malachi chapter 1 and see how the Lord challenged them. Malachi chapter 1 verse 6. Malachi 1 verse 6. A son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be father, where is mine honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? says the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests that despise my name, and ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? Ye offer polluted bread upon mine altar, and ye say, wherein have we polluted thee? In that ye say, the table of the Lord is contemptible, verse 8. And if ye offer the blind for sacrifice, is it not evil? If ye offer the lame and sick, is it not evil? Offer it now unto thy governor. Will he be pleased with thee, or accept thy person, says the Lord of hosts? He said, offer it to your governor, what you are trying to offer to me. Will he accept? Will he be pleased? Will he be happy? If your governor will not accept it, how do you think that I, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, will accept that from your hand? My brothers and sisters, there are some of us who are teaching in primary school or secondary school, and we know as teachers how we prepare our notes of lesson. We know how we prepare before we go to teach. And some of us who are teachers in the school, and we prepare very well, and our students know us to be very good, capable teachers. When we are supposed to teach in the church, the preparation is not as thorough as the preparation we make for the secular world. How can that be? How should that be? And some of us who are here, maybe you have sung songs in the night clubs before. And when you are going to sing in the night club, you prepare yourself. And you should understand, you don't know what we know. We know things that you don't think we know. When you see, for example, those people in the world, when they take that trumpet and it begins to play, and he has all the freedom, and he plays that saxophone, even the people that do not like his attitude or his manner of life or whatever they don't like, when he plays that thing, there is no gainsaying. Those people that go to watch him play, they know that this is a master player in the instrument he has chosen. How is it then when we come to the church, and then we are to offer music unto the Lord? How do we do it? You know how they do it in the world? That those musicians will keep all those people awake for hours in the night, playing for them. And when they eventually finish the playing, the people don't want to go home. And then they say, encore, encore, play it again, give it to us again. If that is how they give them in the world, then we come to the church. What are we offering to the Lord in the church? That's why the Lord is reminding us that whatever we're giving to the Lord, give it all your strength, all your energy, everything that you have got. Train yourself to give the very best unto the Lord, because that's exactly what the Lord wants. That's where holiness comes in. That what you are offering to the Lord must be perfect. That's why he's telling us in 2 Corinthians chapter 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Those of us who know God and love God, we cherish holiness, we accept holiness, and we worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, reading from verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. That's what the Lord desires. Consecration and holiness. I go to point number three. Our continuation in holiness and love. The Lord is challenging us that if we want to see him when he comes, if he is still going to claim us and confess us before his Father and before the holy angels, we must continue in holiness and in love. Holiness unto the Lord is a watchword and song. Holiness unto the Lord, that is who we are. We'll not only sing it and shout it, we will live by it for the rest of our lives. Holiness unto the Lord. You continue in holiness and you continue in love. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 15. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 15. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing, if they continue in faith and charity and holiness or sobriety. She shall be saved in childbearing. If you are a person who reads the news, I don't mean just the news in the newspapers. It's good to read the news in the newspapers, but you need to understand that doctors, for example, they have journals that they read, and they have reports that are given to them. And some of those reports are sectional, like for example, for West Africa, or for East Africa, or sometimes for Africa, or sometimes it will give the doctors information what's happening in the whole of Asia and what's happening in different parts of the world. If you are given to such journals and reading, you will know that in the world many women die at the time of childbirth. And in Nigeria here, the number is terrific and terrifying. The women that die in childbirth. And that's why when the doctors read all those things, they will advise and say, and the reason they do that is because of the knowledge they have, because of statistics. They will say that after you are 35 or 37 or 40 at the most, please don't think of getting pregnant again, because they think of the danger of mortality of the mothers at that age. But the Lord is telling us not to worry about that. 40 years, 45 years, 50 years, if God gives you a pregnancy, there's nothing to worry about, because you are not part of the people of the world. Only one condition, only one condition, whatever your age, whether you are 32 or 38, or you are 44 or 47, or you're even 52 and you are pregnant, look at this: notwithstanding, she shall be delivered and preserved and protected and saved in childbearing. But there's a condition: if they continue in faith, you don't allow doubt, don't allow unbelief, don't allow the stories you are hearing from the world to bring confusion in your heart and to bring fear in your heart. Continue in faith and continue in charity, in love. Don't say, it's because I am pregnant, that's why I'm getting angry. No. Whether you are pregnant or not, you are a child of God, there should be no anger. And they have said that at the early stages of pregnancy, there will be irritation. No, not for a child of God. Whether it's early stage or later stage, you will not be getting angry. You will not be manifesting irritation and wrath and fighting and, having hot temper with your husband as they continue in love, in charity, And if you are there in the church, and maybe you are pregnant at the early stages, and you know, you've read in all those books that whenever you are pregnant like that, if they say anything, a little thing they say like this, you know, because of your hormones and because of this and that, everything will change, you'll be getting angry. And then you know, someone of our ushers came to you and said, "Ah, dear sister, please, we reserve this place for the coordinators or for the members of the choir. Will you please move out of that place and go to this place?" And then you get angry. You people don't look at anybody's face. You don't know who we are. Do you know my condition? Why are you talking to me like that? As if you want to fight. And then somebody who knows you will come to you and say, "Ah, tread softly now. What's the problem?" "Well, really, I'm a nice person, I'm a correct person, but you are my friend. Come here, let me tell you. It's because I am pregnant. That's why I easily get angry now. Because they told us, in fact, the doctor even told me that I'll experience that anger and irritation many, many times because of my condition." My dear sister, it's not so. You are a child of God. You are not an Egyptian. You are not a Philistine. And you are not an Amorite. You are not an Amalekite. You are a child of God, of the people of God. Anger, irritation will not continue in your life in Jesus' name. Notwithstanding, they shall be saved, preserved in childbearing. We will not die. I said we will not die. Because we continue in faith, in charity, in holiness with sobriety. Love must continue and holiness must continue. In Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, verse 22 and verse 23. Colossians 1, 22. In verse 22, "In the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if ye continue." You see the condition. If we're going to meet the Lord on the final day, if our worship will not be in vain, continuation in holiness and love. If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I Paul am made a minister to continue. And that's what the Lord is expecting. What if we don't continue? What if we just feel, well, I'm tired of holiness, I'm tired of purity, I'm tired of sanctification? Well, there's a consequence. In Second Peter chapter 2, verse 20, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ," after we have been saved, after we have been born again, after we have been converted and we are possessed by the Lord, if after that they are again entangled therein, if we go back to sin, if we go back to anger, if we go back to irritation, if we go back to revenge and retaliation, if we go back to malice, if we go back to tale-bearing, gossiping, backbiting, if we go back to hypocrisy, if we go back to the uncleanness that we left before, and we do not continue in holiness and love, if they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning, for it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they had known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his vomit again. And so the swine, the pig that was washed, to a wallowing in the mire. That's why it is dangerous to go back into sin. The Lord wants us to continue in the word of God, continue in the doctrine, continue in righteousness and holiness. Whatever happens, my brothers and sisters, when you came to the church, you didn't come for work. You didn't come for service. You didn't come for activity. You didn't come for position. You came for salvation. And when you got saved, that was the joy of your life. When you got sanctified, that was the greatest possession that you had. It was only later that work came in, activity came in. And activity is not the most important in your life. Preaching is not the most important in your life. And how is it that grudge, bearing grudge, is coming into your heart? Because he didn't put me there. Is that what you came for? Because he didn't give me that opportunity. Is that what you came for? Because he didn't listen to me when I wanted him to do it like this. Is that what you came for? Didn't you come for just salvation, sanctification, and then go to heaven? Why is it you are living the essential thing? And now, because of activity, because of position, because of this, you relegate what will take you to heaven. You are playing with your eternal life. You throw that to the background because of material things, tangible things, physical things, opportunities in the church. Come back. Come back. Don't let the devil take our sanctified sense away. Let's pursue the right thing. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16, take heed to yourself, take heed to thyself, and unto the doctrine. This doctrine of repentance and restitution and righteousness and holiness, take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them. Continue in them. Don't be sidetracked. Don't allow another thing to take their place. Continue in them. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that follow thee. And you must continue in the love of God. You love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. What did Jesus say? Matthew chapter 24, reading from verse 12. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Please, read that verse properly. It doesn't say the love of everybody shall wax cold. Not everybody. Not everybody. The love of many. There will still be some people that will continue in love. And you are one of those people. The hand of the Lord is upon you. The grace of God is in your life. And the love of God will never leave you. The Lord loves you. He is preparing a place for you in heaven. Whatever others do, stand by your consecration, stand by your commitment, stand by your dedication to the love of God, and keep everything on the altar. Whatever you are giving, the Lord will pull it back. And if others are getting angry, you know, you don't have to be like them. You know, by the grace of God, you are free, and you'll be free indeed. Others are getting jealous, don't follow them. Others are getting irritated, don't follow them. Others are not continuing in holiness and love, then you don't have to follow them. Distinguish yourself and make a mark and let them know, brother so and so, no matter what you will lose, no matter even if his closest friend is going to move in to get angry or whatever, he'll say, no, my brother, I love you with the love of God, with the love of Christ. Because he knows, here is the secret of getting to heaven at last. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And even though the love of many shall wax cold, for him is going to endure to the end. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. I look at you and I appreciate the grace of God in your life, and I know you have made up your mind that no matter what happens, in the rain, in the sunshine, whenever Jesus will come, morning, afternoon, or night, when there is money, when there is no money, when we are happy, when we are not happy, whatever is happening around us, the wind is blowing, the rain is falling, the storms are there, and the thunders are clapping, I know you have made up your mind, you will be there. I said you will be there. I said you will be there. Continue. The grace of God will see you through. Rise up and let us pray. Tell the Lord, you'll continue. You will continue. You will continue. You will continue. You will continue. The grace of God will help you. You will not fall by the wayside.